I recently recorded the Imperial March on violin, and I didn't really explain much. I just basically played through it in kind of first-person view. And while my students, who were the ones asking for this, came to me and said that it was cool, there's a lot of accidentals all throughout that little theme, that little melody. And so what I'd like to do on this video is take a moment and break some of those down so that your fingers have a better idea of where to go. So on violin, this will work. And if eventually my goal is to make something similar for viola, cello, and bass. So the original recording had this view. So I had everything kind of laid out with fingerings, but it didn't really explain where fingers should go. So what I'd like to do with you today is walk you through what I think are the 10 maybe confusing accidentals for beginners. There's a process in learning strings and learning these extended third fingers or these pullback first fingers. And this may be putting the cart before the horse, in that a very young player maybe shouldn't be playing this. So if you've been playing for a while now and you have a better understanding of extended thirds or like B flats where you pull the first finger back, then you're in a better place to tackle this. If you're a brand new beginner, maybe not quite ready yet. So let's jump into it. Okay, then I have 10 little boxes and we'll look at one at a time. So the first box is the number one box, is a B flat. And usually if I'm playing a regular B, my finger is slightly, maybe, ahead of the nut. It's about an inch ahead of the nut. But again, remember that this is not a measuring thing, it's a listening thing. So where it sounds correct is where the finger should go. That's a B. To play a B flat, I basically pull that finger back, where I'm now playing a half step from A. So A. Now see how it sounds different? That's a B flat. Again, to hear the difference, whole step to B, B natural, and now that's a B flat. So if I play that now in the song, you will hear how it sounds right. And then all I did there was pull the finger back. Now, do not yank your wrist this way, because that would be an awful, not good thing to do. Pull the finger back. And by the way, the note before that, box number one, the note before that, you notice that little arrow pointing down? Also, a half step from D. It's an E flat. So there's a lot of new notes in here. Or for some people, maybe a lot of new notes. Okay, box number two. Aha! So I just explained that. So box number two is that pull the finger back for a E flat. Now, box number three, usually if I put my fourth finger down, and I play E natural, that E will sound like my open E. Let me show you. Right? So when beginners learn, this is the first place fourth finger goes to. It's a whole step from D. You can see the space between the third finger, D, and the fourth finger, E. In this case, you're playing E flat, which is now a half step from the D. So the fingers are closer. And they're, for my case, I have big hands, so my fingers are touching. So that would sound now like this. Here is that measure number three. Right? Followed by a B flat, which you pull back. Moving on to box number four. Now, you see how there is a third finger with an arrow down. So instead of playing my third finger in where the note G would be, I am actually going to put my third finger where F sharp would be. Think about that. That's F sharp. I'm gonna place my third finger on F sharp. Awkward, weird, strange. range, but G flat and F sharp are the same note. So going from measure three, basically playing F sharp, G flat with third finger. Back to E flat, then B flat, where you pull the finger back, and now G natural. My G returns to the normal place. Let's put it in quotes, the normal place. That's where G goes back. And by the way, it looks like a pound sign, but it's not. It's missing the top little right leg and the bottom little left leg. So it's like a pound sign, but it's missing some of its legs. That's a natural sign. So box number six now is a G. Again, beginners usually learn to place their second finger a whole step away from the first finger. In this case, however, the G is a half step from the F sharp. So I'm gonna pull that finger back so it sounds like this. So that's gonna match my pitch there. Then, normal G, which brings us to box number seven. There's a G flat, and then there is an F natural. So the easiest way to think through that is that G flat, like we learned earlier, on the D string was in the same place as F sharp, and in this case, it's the same. So I put a one finger, and if you play F sharp, or if you finger F sharp, you're also playing G flat. And then notice that the very next note on box seven is the F with an arrow down. So now I want to pull the finger back, right? Like I did for the B flat and the E flat on the A string and the D string. I hope you're following that, right? So basically from let's say from box number six, I would have here goes F sharp fingering, G flat, right? Now, box number eight has an E that has a natural sign. So what does that mean? That E has to sound like open E. So with my fourth finger, now I'm gonna finger that E so that it sounds like my fourth finger E. It should not sound like box number three, which was an E flat. So now the very next note is a D sharp, right? So what does that mean? That D sharp, if my regular third finger is here, right? If my regular three, let's call it D natural, right? My D natural is here and my E is here. You notice how, again, we have a whole step between D and E, whole step between D and E. The D sharp, since sharps raise notes, that D sharp now is a half step higher. So I'm gonna extend third finger, so it's right close to the E. I mean, in my hands, they're touching, right? But it's not about where your hand, it's about where it sounds correct, right? So again, E, D sharp, back to E. If I play from box six, now we have this. And now, if you're getting that, you're like, okay, that's cool. We're sounding like the Imperial March. Now, box number nine, I have to extend third finger, right? We just learned D sharp on the A string was you have your usual D natural, your regular third finger placement, right? And you extend it. Now imagine regular G natural placement where you usually place for G. G sharp, again, since sharps makes notes go up, we're extending G sharp to play the note correctly. So that's G sharp. The very next note is C sharp, that every beginner who plays violin knows where that C sharp falls. And finally, box number 10. Box number 10 is a B sharp, right? And in terms of finger placement, B sharp falls in the same place as C natural. So let's find it, right? If I have C sharp, and sharps raise notes, and here's my B, right? And here's my C sharp, because sharps raise notes, if I play C natural, I'm going a half step lower. Remember, sharps and flats will raise or lower a note by a half step. In the violin first position, usually it looks like a little bit of space between the fingers or fingers fairly close together, generally, right? So I have C sharp right before box 10, and now B sharp, which is the same finger play, the same pitch as C natural, so I'm gonna lower my second finger, right? And now notice how it's right next to the B natural, which I also need to play right after box 10. So like from box 9 to box 10, I have G sharp, C sharp, lower that second finger, that's box 10, and now first finger B. And from that line, those last two lines, the notes repeat. Some of those places we just covered are the same. And so what you should be able to do now is to review that, I would go back, right? I would basically go back and listen to the video one more time to make sure that you are understanding where those places go. And then from there, it's going back to the original video where I am playing through it. And I think you should be much more successful now that we've gone through and done that whole explanation. And so it would help me if you guys let me know if the video is helpful, because I think a format like this where you explain things could be a beneficial thing for students, you know, young and old. So let me know. That actually helps me determine how to teach in a format like this. So teaching is a passion of mine. So if it's helping people in the way that I'm explaining it, that's a good thing. So thank you for learning, and I will see you again in the very, very near future. Thanks again.